serious. She was serious about salvation. And the one thing that I would like to say, you know, I thank God for the time that we have had with our mother. They moved down here with me about 40 years ago after the loss of my husband, Sergeant Willie Creighton. I thank God that they uprooted, left jobs, and may you know, left jobs, and they moved down here to take care of me during the time that I was going through, shortly after I went through cancer, and they was right there. I thank God for a mother that was sold out. I thank God for a mother that even during my times of sickness, how she closed herself in and she prayed for me. She prayed for me, and she didn't only pray for me. I was healed by her prayer. When they sent me to Texas, it was only a spot. That's the woman that I know. That's the woman that I know that could get in contact with God. And that's what we need now, y'all. We need some people now that can get in contact with God. Amen. As we go through this virus, as we go through this coronavirus, amen, it's time for us, amen, if she could pray cancer away, don't y'all know that we can come together as a whole and pray this away? Y'all may not think it can be done, but it can. Amen. I stand on the scripture. I stand on what God say. Now, before I close out, we want somebody to pick them up and put them down, because that's what she would do. Amen. She would praise the Lord. Amen. She, I started writing down some of the things that my mother would say. My mother would, she would tell us, she would get at us, tell us, I'm not crazy. You know, when people start getting old, when they start getting older, amen, we want to put them in a set category. But my mother, she would even tell the white people, I'm not old. I'm not crazy. But I just can't hear. Amen. And she would go with another little phrase. Y'all want to tell what it was? She did the Judge Judy thing on us. I got more sense in one side of my head than some of y'all got in your whole head. Amen. As I began to talk to people, they talked about how sharp she was. From Dr. Adams' office to dialysis, to her driver that took her to dialysis, she was a sharp woman. As I began to look at some of her pictures that my niece had sent, she was a fox, too. You know, I guess that's what the young folks say. Is that what the young folks say? Yeah. Amen. She was good looking. Amen. Now, these was some that we chose. I did one for my brother because he wanted to see her in her natural. And we did find one. Tara did find one with her in her with her natural hair. But Pastor Mitchell, she was a sharp dresser. She was a dresser that was always in her heels. Amen. And she was busy for the Lord. Amen. You talking about a one woman army? That's what she was. And that's why I don't give up. Amen. With ministry, with some of the challenges that we go through, because mama didn't give up. Amen. And if I would say to the family and families, her favorite scriptures was Romans 12:1. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Holiness, that's the only way God is going to accept us. Mama planted seed in us. Let's make her proud. I know I didn't finish that scripture. Let's make her proud. Let's make her proud of everything that she put in us. She would love to look down and see her children, her grandchildren, her greats, full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. She would love to see that. Don't think that you got everything in your hand, because you don't. Your plans is not in your hand. Look at everybody in here with masks on. Look at everybody that have dreams. Look at everybody that have jobs. Amen. We shut down, y'all. We have no control. God is in control. So I want to encourage in my family. I want to encourage in your family. I want to encourage in the families wherever you are, pass it on. Let's come together. Amen. Let's bring out, somebody said she was the tightest woman. Let's bring out the tightest women. Amen. Let's bring out the Proverbs 31 women. You know, I thank God for my niece, and I don't want to embarrass her. I hope I don't embarrass her, but I know I won't. You know, I had to really get on her case the other day. I thank God for her. When I called her and got on her case, I was about ready to throw the towel in, let alone.
When my little boy, when my son, when he was a little boy, and I would be out cutting the grass. Now, I got a real lawnmower. I mean, it blade, it cuts grass. But I bought him a little bit of one that was a play mower. Because he wanted to be like daddy. He wanted to cut the grass. And so I'm out there mowing, he right behind me. He mowing the grass, but he ain't cutting it. I'm cutting. Now what happens is that once he get old enough and mature enough, then he could use the real lawnmower to cut the grass. See? And that's the thing about it. You've got to train them. In other words, let them imitate you so they'll know what's right and what's wrong. But you know, people will tell you, well, can't nobody live holy. Can't nobody live right. The thing about it is that God said, you ought to be holy. Why? Because I am holy. And then you find out in another place over in 1 Peter, he said, I want you to live holy because what? It is written. Holy. What more proof do you need? It's written. So we can see that it's important to live right.
Yes, sir.
Now, if you truly love God, then you ought to want to pattern your lives after him. But we still have people saying, no one can live holy. And the thing about it is that the people that is said, all of them are in the world. All of them in the world say, you got some sitting next to you in the church today that's saying the same thing. You are going shopping at the mall with people saying the same thing. I don't believe that you can live that way. Well, you're going to have to deal with God. Holiness is not a religion. It is the way of the Lord. Now, when you look at this thing, this thing began before the beginning of time.
Watch out.
You find in Ephesians 1 and 4, he says, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him. And look. Now look, he chose us. We didn't choose him. In other words, we can't save ourselves. So he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. Well, how are we supposed to be? We're supposed to be holy.
Yes.
Now, I know you want to argue with me on that because you think of holiness or holy as you look up in your dictionary may be totally different from what God is saying.
That's right.
In your own mind of interpretation, you might say it means to dot every I and cross every T. But God says that your ways are not my ways. Your thoughts are not my thoughts. So you can't line up his holiness with your holiness. They are different. So we see that in the Old Testament, in Leviticus 10 and 10, he says that ye may put a difference between holy and unholy, between unclean and clean. Now, it says you do it. It says you put a difference between clean and unclean, between unclean and clean, holy and unholy. You've got to do that. Now, you can't do it by yourself. It takes a God working on the inside of you to live this life. I heard him say, without me, you can't do nothing. But I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. So it need, you need a power of the Holy Ghost living on the inside. And the thing about it is that we have to make a difference. You can't be like everybody else. Ain't nobody saying amen, but I'm going to say it anyway. You can't be like everybody else. I look at 1 Peter 2 and 9. Now, this is what it says. This is the reason you can't be like everybody else. Because you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation, a peculiar. Hey, you peculiar. You ain't like nobody else. You ain't trying to be like nobody else. Because you are different. You are what? You're peculiar. Why are you peculiar? So that you should show forth the praise of him who have called you us out of darkness into this marvelous light. That's why you're different. You can't be like everybody. You can't go to places where everybody else go. You can't talk like everybody else is talking. Can't do it. And not be holy. And be saved. You can't do it. But I still hear the argument in my mind. Somebody still saying, you can't live that way. You just can't do it. The Bible said that we were all sinners. Now listen, we were all sinners. Yes, were, you want to put that in, the past tense. We were. That means it was past tense. Now, what's the difference in a sinner and somebody just seen? Now, a sinner is somebody that constantly sins. They ain't trying to get right. But the point is that if you sin and you repent and you get up, say, I ain't gonna stay, I ain't gonna wallow in the mess. I'm getting up out of it. All right. You ain't got to stay there because God has strengthened you to come out of it. But when we say things like that, God comes right back at us. He comes right back. I don't care how we try to get around it. I remember I preached one time, God said it, he won't take it back. And he ain't, when it come down to living right, when it come down to holiness and righteousness, he won't take it back. Now he says again, Matthew 5 and 48, be ye therefore perfect. That's messing with somebody's mind right there. Be ye therefore perfect. It's messing with your mind. I can fill it up here. You don't understand the word. But God says, be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Understand that. He created us. He wants to be like him. Now, you got sense. You got kids. Now, if you're any kind of parent, you want your kids to be like you, don't you? I know you do. Especially if you're living a good life, a righteous life. You want to be just like you. Now, if they don't, you are disappointed in them. We are God's. He created us in his image. Not ours. We didn't even have one. But in his image, we are to imitate him. We are to be like him. Don't be afraid to use the word holiness, perfect, perfection. That's what he is. We can be nothing less. That's what he wants to be. Then I no word, I'm going to give you some words. You won't say you didn't get no word today because I'm going to give it to you. Acts 17 and 30. And the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now command all men everywhere to repent. In other words, it's ignorant. We was ignorant. We didn't know any better. And God winked at our sins. You know what? He overlooked them. But now he said he's command. He's commanding us that we repent. All men everywhere. I don't care who you are, where you come from. You got to live right. If you don't, you ain't going to heaven. You won't make it. The way you die is the way you will get up when you rise from the grave. If you die holy, you don't get up holy. If you die unsaved, you coming up unsaved. Once you are placed in the grave, Ain't no time to get right then.
That's right.
The time to get right is now.
Now.
It's now. And if you don't do it, it's nobody's fault but yours. Then in 2 Corinthians 6 and 17, the word says, "Wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean things, and I will receive you." Now, you got some of us is trying to be part of the world and part of it. It don't work that way. He says, come out from among them. Now, I wonder why he said that. Come out from among them, because what you're trying to spell the fence. It won't work. What's going to happen is if you don't come out from among them where you thought you were saved, you find yourself unsaved because you're mixing and mingling with unsaved people. So he says, come out from among them. Then I see in that New Testament scripture, Titus 2, 11 and 12, for the grace of God, which is Jesus Christ, that bringeth salvation has appeared to some men. No. Has appeared to all men. What does that do? It's teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts. What we should do? We should live soberly and righteously and godly in the world to come. That's it, mother. In this present world, that's what has happened. Folks, you can't live this life until you're gapping, you're ready to die, you're about to get out of here. No. God said, you've got to live this life right here in this present world. What you going to do when you die? What can you do? You can't live nothing in the grave. There's nothing to happen in the grave. So you've got to do it now. While you have breath in your body. Then I see in Hebrews, I'm about to wind it up. Hebrews 12 and 14. He says, follow peace with all men. Follow peace with all men and holiness. Without no man shall do what? See the Lord. We've got to know, my brothers and my sisters, that if we want to see the Lord, we've got to follow peace with all men and holiness. The Bible recorded great men of God that lived and they walked with God. They live right and they walk with God. For the Bible declared that Enoch walked with God. He was not, for God took him. For we found out that Enoch walked so righteous with God that God decided he would not allow him to see death. We kept on looking and turning the pages. And the Bible said that Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He was a just man, perfect in his generations, and Noah walked with God. If you listen to what I'm saying, these great men of God, they walk with God, and you can't walk with God any kind of way. I heard God say himself, as he declared the word of God, and began to talk about Job. He said Job was a perfect and upright man, one that feared God and hated evil. Bless God. My God is able to keep you against that day. I heard him when he began to speak to Abraham. My brothers and my sisters, it makes no difference how old you get. I heard him when he began to speak to Abraham. He said, Abraham, I am the Lord your God. I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thy perfect. I began to search that thing and look at the Almighty God. When you look at it in the Hebrew, it means El Shaddai, an all-sufficient God. God that is more than enough. It makes no difference how old you get. God is saying, walk before me and be thy perfect. Hallelujah. I could see Job. Hallelujah. Job was a perfect and upright man. God bragged on him because of his righteousness. Can he brag on you? Can he say, look, devil, I got Job here. He's righteous. He's one that hate evil. Can he count on you to live that life? I saw Job began to go through so many things, but he held to his integrity. Look here, my brothers and my sisters. I remember, hallelujah, when Lazarus died. He began to stink in his grave. He was there for 4 long days. My brothers and my sisters, somebody today, hallelujah, you're dead in trespasses and sin, and you began to stink in your grave. But look here, I saw Jesus when he stepped up to the grave. Yes, he did. I declare, he said, I am the Almighty. But he told them, he said, move the stone. In other words, roll the stone away. And he began to call Lazarus by his name. Look here, when he called him, Lazarus answered because his name was called. I'm glad that he didn't call everybody's name and said, dead, rise. They would have came forth. But look here, he's calling your name today. Bobby and Sue, you're dead in trespasses and sin. Shirley, Jerry, come forth, hallelujah, and let your sins be washed away, hallelujah. But look here, how are we going to do this thing? How are we going to get by? I heard the word say, hallelujah, you need the power of the Holy Ghost. What is the Holy Ghost? A power that will lead you and guide you and show you things that come. But I heard Jesus said, go down, hallelujah, to Jerusalem and stay there until you be endued from power on high. Yes, but I heard Peter, as I close, he preached the word, hallelujah, on the day of Pentecost. Yes, he did. He preached his soul, and they said, men and brothers, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, not one of you, but all of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission, hallelujah, of your sins. If the name is not used, the sin is not remitted, then you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. May God bless you, and may he keep you. It's our praise. There might be somebody today that's not in our safety. We want to extend the invitation to you today to come. We got time to take you in. Are you here? Are you here today? If not, film directors.
Hallelujah.
Our seniors are welcome to stay in the fellowship hall till we come back. Seniors, you may stay in the fellowship hall till we come back. Anybody that want to stay in the fellowship hall until we come back from the cemetery.
Any seniors who would like to stay in the fellowship hall until they return from the burial, you're welcome.
Pure anointing holy oil, healing oils of the Bible. No home or church should be without pure anointing holy oil. For more information, please contact area code 334-226-1701. That's area code 334-226-1701 for your pure anointing holy oil.